was a sergeant, I'm not sure he was one. My boss has turned up. He wants to see you in that lorry. A few choice words, and we lowered the tailboard, and the bloke comes along. I don't want to see that. Shut it up. And then we had to keep the back door locked. So they told us. So we're all diving in and out the fire door there, so that we could see what was happening, because she was about 45 minutes late when she arrived.
Mm.
And, well, you know more about than I did, because I couldn't see 90% of it.
No, but you were listening to me relay
asking
about it in the theatre.
Yeah.
There was a moment there where I felt very privileged, but I felt it was wrong of me to do it. But it was Michael Landon told me that they had finally got the rest of the money.
Mm-hmm.
And the debt had all been cleared that week, or that day almost. And I said, well, tell them, you know, tell everybody in the audience. We're waiting inside. He said, no, you say it. So I made the announcement. I said, I'm very pleased to announce that the fundraising has finally reached its goal, and the £55,000 has been reached. And there was a huge round of applause. The only round of applause I've ever had from the theatre. But since then, of course, there's been another extension, hasn't there?
Yes. Well, we tried to get lottery money. We wanted to extend at this end. We had all the plans. We were going to put another dressing room back to back with this one out there, and then beyond that, a scenery store. On the plans, there was because we can't alter the front of the building, they put a run back wall. So you had a little triangular room at the end, which was going to be a little kitchen. At that end, we had showers, and rather than put another toilet in, they left a toilet in this one. Put a shower in the other one, that was the idea, and so on. New doorway, and well, we got the plans, we were looking at them, and they'd done a sort of recess to the door, and it went all the way out. I said, well, why can't we do it like the front door? Bring it out over the top, it gives us more room, and that was part of the design. And then several times, because I'd packed up work, and David Ames asked me to come along to meet with these various people, and we met the local Arts Council chap, and then the regional one, and then we had a chap come down from London, met with all these. And I don't recall any of them actually getting the plans out and looking at the plans to see what we wanted to do. But all they could ask was, what is your ethnic mix? And when David said, we don't know, why not? Well, people come along, they fill in a membership form, they pay their money, they're a member. If we start asking about ethnic mix and things like that, we're going to be accused of all sorts of bias and racism. And they couldn't see that.
In other words, ethnic mix didn't matter at all.
Well, it don't matter to us, no.
Oh, quite, absolutely.
As long as they've got the money.
Yeah, and they want to do something.
Yeah.
Yeah, quite, yeah.
And it went on like this for ages. And we used to have Jackie Lay, who was in her MP. She used to come in quite often because she'd got a place down here. And every time she came in, she used to say to me, how's the thing going on for the extension? As soon as you get it to the lottery people, let me know and I'll do all I can for it. And I said, well, they're on this business now, we must put in a lift. We'd had a disabled audit, which you had to have. And that had said, we don't need a lift in because you can't alter the balcony to accommodate wheelchairs, and any bar service can easily be organised. It's a waste of money and time and space. So after the national bloke had been here, we got a phone call apparently the next day saying, you're not going to get any money unless you put a lift in. So David said, can you come down tomorrow morning and meet with me and the architect? I've got an idea where we can put it. Well, I've got ideas where we put the lift, but the people in the arts camp, the lottery wouldn't have liked it because it would have been painful. His idea was to put it at that doorway at the bottom of the stairs, going upstairs. So I said, well, it loses an office, loses a kitchen. I said, now, you're planning to alter the coffee bar to make it wide enough to get a wheelchair through to the disabled toilet. Yeah, that's right. And, well, just beyond the wall, if we went through that wall, it's only a boiler house. There's a small boiler and a load of rubbish in there. We could go through there, come straight up, and outside the ladies' toilet would be there. So we measured it all up, and he said, the architect said, I should give you a medal. He said, it's a damn good idea. And they worked it out. It was going to cost something like 20,000. So within 24 hours, we told them, I sent those details to them, it's going to cost about 20,000. We can put it in there. And we were complimented in the final result of how quickly we'd done it and how good we'd done it. But you can't have the money. By this time, we saved, we gathered quite a lot, you know, in the funds. So David sort of pushed some ideas, and they came up with an idea extending out that way, as we've done. And I said, well, we looked at these new plans. I said, well, we can't have that bit currently. Maybe if you, supposing we could put on the new entrance door and bring it along a bit, it could give us the space for the showers, and then all we'd have to do, if we can get the rest of it knocked through. Oh no, no, they'd never allow that, they'd never do that. So I said, well, you know, we don't know, ask. So the next lot of plans that came in, because he was going to use part of the dock where we got our workshop now as a kitchen, which would have reduced the space we got, been better, we'd have had more space than we had, but and the next lot we got was putting the kitchen outside, a room above it, just what we've got now.
Very neat. Very neat.
It worked, but
so
such a shame that we
couldn't. If we go back to 1959,
mm-hmm.
the conversion of the completely wrecked stables cost £15,000.
15,000 pounds.
The new extension that the Queen Mum opened in 1978 cost £55,000.
Mm-hmm.
How much did the last extension cost?
I can't recall. I'm not sure that I ever heard the final figures, but it was pretty well as much, I suspect.
Yes, at least, I should think, yes, because it was racking up all the time.
Yeah, and then, yes. Of course, these silly people with the... that I want it all put there so as it looks just the same as the rest, which you never can.
It'll weather. Yeah.
But you'd have to come back in 200 years' time to see it. You can't match it perfectly. I mean, they've done a good job.
Yeah, quite, yes. Yes, indeed.
But that was a bit half-cocked almost. We got the plans, and then they ran into problems with some drainage underneath, and they had to put instead of just a perimeter foundation, they had to put a concrete base down. And I used to come down as I was able to most mornings and got to know the foreman, which I thought was useful, you know, keep him with us. And he said one morning I came in and they got up to about almost a floor level. He said, we're going to put the joists. He says, I thought you wanted more storage space. I said, yeah, of course we do. That's what it's for. We said, why aren't we using the bit underneath? Didn't know we could. We said, we're putting the choices in there. Simplest thing is for us to put a trap in. So I phoned David, he phones the architect, we had a trap put in. So we now got storage underneath the extension.
If you hadn't been here and spoken to the chap, you probably wouldn't have got that.
And then they built up and got up to the top level, put in the joists, going to put the joists in for the roof. And he said, you're still wasting space, aren't you? I said, why? He said, yeah, surely it's going to be like the stage, just going to go up. No, he says, we've got to put a ceiling up there. I said, we don't want a ceiling in the same dock, you know, it's total waste. So he said, well, it'd be the easiest thing in the world to put, instead of putting ceiling on the underside of the joist, put flooring on the top of them and make another trap. Got hold of David, he got hold of the architect, so we had a trap put up there and lighting put up there, and it's but it was, it turned out, because the architect had problems, his wife was very ill, I believe, at the time, and shortly after it was done, he died very suddenly, so maybe that was something to do with it, and it went off.
So, looking forward, what things do you now need in the theatre? What do you want to replace or renew or alter?
Well, gradually, most things, I suppose. I mean, the art gallery needs new lighting in. We've got to do, the roof has all got to be done, or at least a lot of it, if not all of it, which is going to be in the region of 60,000, I think.
Astonishing, isn't it?
Yeah. But it's got to be, because it's all got to be in keeping. I mean, about 90% of the original tiles were replaced in 1989. But they're getting tired. A lot of them can be replaced, but then they've got to source replacement ones. And there's a heck of a lot of work to be done up there. We've had about 3 quotes come in, I think it was. One came in as a single sheet of paper saying it'll be so much. Another one wasn't much better. And the company turned up with a cherry picker hoist, went right up onto the roof. They went up in the roof. They've taken photographs of all the bits and pieces, and it's all listed and labelled as to what, and then there's a whole quote of what's needed. So, provided we can get some assistance from the Heritage Lottery and anybody else that'll give us money, we'll be away.
What about on the technical side inside? Lighting and switchboard and sound and so on?
Well, gradually replace. I mean, it all gets old. There's all sorts of things on the market. As you know from your sound stuff, as soon as you buy a thing, it's obsolete, they're changing it. But a lot of these new lights now, you get a single light, and you don't have to put any gel in front of it. It's all LEDs, light emitting diodes. And you've got red, blue, green, and some of them got amber, some of them have got white, some have got all 5. And you just light up the ones you want, and the computer lights up the ones you want. And in various shades, so you get a whole rainbow of colours from the lamp. But they cost money. And then you've got to have all the equipment to operate them as well.
And of course video is coming more and more into the fore, isn't it, these days? People want to use video actually in plays now, don't they?
Yeah. I'm not sure, you can do it for some effects, but you can go too far, can't you?
Oh yes, you've got to be careful with it, yes.
I mean, you want a video, why not get a DVD and watch it that way?
Now, I'm thinking about video effects on the stage with a play.
Yeah,
okay. Like we did with Peter Pan.
Yeah, you've got to do all sorts, you can do all sorts, but you've got to have equipment and things. Are you going to use it enough to warrant the outlay?
Well,
we shall see.
I first interviewed you in 1975.
Oh, God, was it that long ago?
This interview has been a little longer and covering a lot more. And both of us have worked here quite a long time now, on and off. You more continuously than me. But what's your final thoughts as we come to the end of this little chat?
Oh, no. Long rain the stables, I suppose. We're the greatest.
Quite.
And if we don't think so, why should anybody else?
That's a good note to finish on, John. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.